Our final speaker for this session is Lefteris Kokaris-Kogias from Novi Research and ISD Austria, who will be discussing Joltian and Ditto network adaptive efficient consensus with asynchronous fallback.
So in this talk, basically, we looked into existing consensus protocols like Hostaff and Tendermint and try to see what we can get out of them once we kind of open them. And the main motivation was that if we look at them, they really focus on getting a linear steady state communication, and that is pretty important, and we agree on that. But the truth is that once the system crashes and we need to kind of stabilize, you need a quadratic pacemaker. Of course, there are probabilistic solutions to make it linear, but if we are deterministic protocols, everyone needs to get everything, so reliable broadcast, so eventually it's quadratic. So we came with the question of, in the end, what can we gain by this quadratic cost in the crash when something goes bad? And the answer is two things. One is a system we call Joltian, which basically manages to get the lower latency of Tendermint with the responsiveness of the view change of Hotstuff. And of course, the cost is quadratic on the view change, but that happens only when we have a view change. The steady state communication is still linear. And the second answer is Ditto, which is basically an extension of Joltian where we remove the partial synchronous view change and instead have an asynchronous path, which gives us liveness even under, for example, having Ditto's attacks on the leaders. So let's look a bit into how we achieve this. And to start, we can just look into Hotstuff. The basic idea of Hotstuff is that we have blocks. Every block gets a quorum certificate, and then we build a chain. And once we get a nice three chain, then the third block basically commits the first one. And if we look into the Hotstuff proofs, we can be very quickly convinced that any fork from the certificate K is going to be both safe and live when the leader crashes, for example. On the other hand, we can look into something like Tendermint. Tendermint can easily be constructed as being a two-chain version of Hotstuff. So we remove one chain and we have to look a bit more strictly. However, then if we look into how the view change works, we realize that a responsive fork from K is not live. And by responsive, we mean that once the leader gets 2F+1 messages, they actually try to do something. Instead, for Tendermint to actually get a live view change, the leader has to wait for Delta and make sure that the leader gets messages from every honest party. Now let's look into why this happens. So let's try to run a view change on Tendermint. So first we have some leader that managed to create block BK+2. So there was the K+1 certificate and the leader sends this to a single honest party. Everyone else doesn't manage to get it, and then the leader crashes. Then the new leader shows up. He asks around what is the best quorum certificates you've seen and gets from the 2F honest parties that didn't get the last block K, and some Byzantine party can also send K. Why not? Whatever we want, we send. As a result, the leader says, okay, that looks fine. I'm going to propose a fork from K. But the thing is that once that fork is proposed, the Byzantine party does not accept the proposal. And the honest party that got the certificate from K+1 also cannot accept the proposal. As a result, this is not live. So the leader will be timed out and we're going to have to do the same again. So we might ask ourselves, can we, for example, relax a bit the locking rule? Maybe this way we can help the leader run. And if we try to do that, we're going to quickly see that this is not safe. So for example, here, very similar example, we have the previous leader that has sent the K+2 block to all honest parties. They vote for it, they create a certificate, and as a result, the next leader gets the nice certificate and says, okay, BK+1 is committed. We're in a two-chain rule. And then it crashes. Since no other party saw K+2 certificate, they're still locked in K. So if a Byzantine leader shows up, now he can easily propose a fork on K+1, and that would be fine. No, propose. No one knows K+1, so he proposed a fork on K. So BK+1 is forked out. And as a result, the previous leader that crashed is no longer safe. So as a result, this is unsafe. We need to do something better. And the basic solution here is that the leader actually has to prove that no one else saw this K+1 certificate. And as a result, the proposal is actually fair, because basically block A plus one cannot be committed. And that's basically how we do it. This is actually very similar to yesterday's talk of Neil with no commits proof, because you can see of what we generate also as a no commit proof of the block A plus one. How this works is that every party is going to send to the leader what is the highest QC they have locked. The leader is going to collect these 2F plus one quorum certificates and put them inside the block after a view change. So if you see, this block is actually linear in size, but these are only blocks after a view change. All normal blocks are still constant sized. This is actually enough to convince every party that there is no one that has committed something and they can actually unlock what they thought is the highest certificate. For example, a party that has committed K plus one could unlock. So maybe if we look into an example of why this is safe, if here we have F on S parties that gave their high QCs being K plus one, so this is the block, there's only K plus one here. This means that if the leader forks over K plus one, that should be fine, because there cannot be any K plus two certificate, as K plus three certificate. As a result, the block K plus two has not been committed. Even if someone saw the K plus two certificate, this would be only a minority of nodes. So not enough votes were collected for K plus three to be created. As a result, we can easily fork over K plus one. If we look on the other hand, if someone has committed, if on the other hand, someone did commit block K plus one, this means that the certificate K plus two has been formed. For it to be formed, it means that F plus one nodes have actually voted for block K plus two and witnessed certificate K plus one. As a result, when the leader is collecting the highest certificates during the view change, at least one of them will reveal the K plus one certificate to the leader, and he will not be able to fork beforehand. I hope that is kind of clear, but you can look also into the paper for more information. And we actually implemented it and compared it to hot stuff. And as expected, we see a latency reduction of around 33%. And that's basically because we get one less round trip when we actually commit the block. Next, let's move to Dito. And the basic idea is here, since we are paying quadratic for the view change, why aren't we doing something better? Why aren't we creating a protocol that can withstand the bad network that we are just being hit? Like, to get in a view change, your network is bad or your leaders are being under attack most of the time. So if this is the case, instead of trying to wait until GST shows up again and we have synchrony, we should be able to make advancements even if we have a bit less network, which is, I guess, also the message that Quang had beforehand. So how do we do it? I guess the first question to ask is, if you look at the example that I said before on Tendermint and why it is unsafe, if you actually ask yourself, is there a specific use case where Tendermint's leader actually could be live without waiting for Delta? The answer is that in a previous example, there is a single leader that has this ability, and it is that honest node that got the highest certificate. That honest node doesn't need to wait for no one else. That honest node has the highest certificate, and he will not propose the bad block. As a result, if we create a leaderless view change, so everyone can be the leader, that one node is going to give the liveness of the system. So if we look into how the view change of Dito works, we still have this nice two chain. We have the strict locking rule that Tendermint has, not the more relaxed that Jordan has. And what happens is that when a node realizes that the leader is crushed, the node basically says, okay, in my point of view, that should be the next block. I fork the chain with my best certificate. And every node does the same. Some nodes, in my previous example, are going to fork the chain at the place where their fork is not live. But there has to be at least one node that forks it correctly. And that one node is going to get liveness, is going to get a certificate from everyone else and continue the chain of that honest node. Once everyone else realizes that, they're going to basically update their prediction and extend the best chain they know. we're going to do it a third time, and that is going to be because we want the libraries in asynchrony. And once we have two F plus one valid chains inside the view chains, we can just flip a coin, and hopefully one of the leaders that actually finished the chain with constant probability is going to be elected. And then we basically act as if nothing else has happened. We look into the chain of that leader. We say that is the only thing that has happened. We have no idea about all the other forks in the view chains. And we look at the chain as if it is a classic two-chain Hostaff chain. And this, if you can see here, makes sure that we commit a block every view chains. Even if you are under attack, even if F nodes are crashed or being DDoSed, this is an asynchronous way to always get liveness during unstable networks. And then we have elected the leader. The leader is going to continue doing the job of the fast path of the partial synchrony, propose a block, gets it committed, et cetera. So we implemented and evaluated all those protocols, and we also implemented and evaluated a version of VABA, which is an asynchronous protocol that is basically very similar to the view chains of DTO. And if we can see here, we evaluated with 10, 20, 50 nodes. And this is the execution with no faults. So the very nice synchronous network execution. So here we can see that the asynchronous solution is of course the slowest, both in latency, and it doesn't achieve that high throughput. That's expected because of the quadratic communication complexity. Whereas Jolteon, Hotstuff, and DTO are more or less similar. The changes are basically a bit lower latency for Jolteon and DTO because of the one less chain. And then we get a bit more capacity also there, but very minor changes in the common case. The big difference shows up when we start having faults. So in this experiment, we crash one faulty nodes and three nodes with a 20 node experiment. So if we see when everything is beautiful, you see here how much faster the partial synchronous protocols are, including DTO, who pays a small price here because sometimes a view chain is going to be triggered because of instability, while VABA suffers significantly. The moment we get even a single fault, VABA starts to win by much. DTO manages to go somewhere in between, and Jolteon and Hotstuff are actually getting slower, and that is because of the rotating leaders than the two-chain rule. And with three faults, it's even more prevalent that the protocols are actually getting view chains all the time. This is actually a 5-second view chain, so it actually pays off. We did try to find the best parameter for a view chain, we then set it to 1/2 second, and you can see that there is a high cost here. Finally, we also basically simulated an attack on the leaders by crashing the leader every time they're elected. As expected, Hotstuff and Jolteon are basically not live. There's nothing happening here, they're on zero. While DTO and VABA behave very similarly, VABA is slightly faster, and that happens because DTO, due to its adaptivity, sometimes has to wait for a timeout before going to the view chain's asynchronous path. And basically we can see that here where the latency is higher, and that's basically the timeout. We have evaluated here the case where we present a fallback. So basically the idea is that in DTO, if you get a timeout and then a second timeout, you're not going to wait for a third timeout. Then you run 5 asynchronous runs, you try again, and you try to adapt that way. But I would say it's an open question on how best to adapt between how often do we invoke the fast path and how often we invoke the slow path. And I'd say that's it. And I'm open to questions. Thank you.